Hello there, everybody, and welcome back for more Hardcore Heroes. So, Richie, I'm sorry, Richie comes in and follows you upstairs, Van. And the two of you are now seated in your room together. It's
Good. I heard
quiet.
Reggie and I was like, didn't I kill this guy already?
No, but Clifford should have by now.
No, wasn't Reggie the
black market halfling foot dealer?
Yes, but we didn't kill him. He was in jail, and he was
Oh yeah,
going to
that's
go
right.
to somewhere for trial, and then I paid for Clifford to kill the shit out of him.
Oh yeah.
Anyways.
It's the din of the downstairs commotion falls away, and it's quite quiet in this room, just the two of you. He stands and paces nervously, looks up and goes, I really don't want to be involved. You know,
I
people go
understand. I
missing, people
understand.
get stabbed. I don't want to be on the part of that. So I just came here to tell you, I don't want to be involved.
I understand that. But now that you're here, I don't see any harm in answering a few questions. We're out of earshot from any prying eyes.
I can answer a few questions, but I gotta get going soon. What is it?
Yes, we'll make it quick. What do you know of a man named Boren?
Merchant in town. He's done very
Yes,
well for
and
himself. He just bought a new shop.
has he had any dealings with the other merchants? We know Hitchens was having his business pried into by somebody that he was very scared of, fearful for his life. And we believe that they are somehow in connection with Boren. Boren had a string of strangely good luck, strangely good fortune.
Can't say I know much about that. He and I deal in different wares entirely.
I
He
see. So
doesn't
there's.
touch the pottery industry.
So I. What does he deal in?
More expensive goods.
Jewelry.
Yeah, some jewelry here, silks, the finer things in life, the things that are you can fetch more per weight.
Okay, I understand. Something else. We're alone in this room, right? Croak didn't show up in
Just
time.
the two of you.
Okay. That's inconvenient.
I'm on my way.
You get in as he's walking out. No, I suppose that does it then. Do you know anyone I could? I do not wish to speak to Boren directly. I don't wish to give him any reason to be wary of me, but do you know who I could talk to learn a little bit more about him?
Without talking to him?
Yes, perhaps one of the merchants that he might have been dealing with. We know that he was in contact with Hitchens. Are there?
Yeah, I mean, just walk down the boardwalk, you find a jeweler, find a silk salesman. More appropriately, you find someone who's bringing foreign goods into town, or is about to buy them and take off. Talk to the sailors, talk to the ship captains, see what they're carrying. You find someone who is carrying something that Boren might want, they might have dealings with him.
Very well. Thank you.
Yeah.
I do not wish to put you in any more danger. Please leave while it's in a short meeting.
Yeah, I hope never to see you again. No
Of
offense.
course. I may pick up a vase. I can't promise that I won't do that, but otherwise that will be the end of our dealings. And I just kind of smile at him after that.
He gives you a wary nod and excuses himself and departs. Sometime later, Croak shows up.
Okay. I say to Croak, our friend didn't know anything himself, but I believe we may have a lead as to where we should look. Seems Boren does not deal in goods that sell for small prices. He tends to deal in very high-priced goods, jewelry, silks. Perhaps we should be looking into some merchants who trade in goods like these, or foreign goods, or apparently something else he is interested in.
Perhaps we could pose as some recent traders that came to town. See if we could learn a little bit more about him as not ourselves.
We could also simply question a few sailors. I believe somebody who does not live in this town may be somewhat more loose-lipped.
It's possible, yes. That's a reasonable idea. I would be happy to question some sailors if we could. Correct me if I'm wrong, though. Traders tend to be a bit tight-lipped about their sources and whatnot.
I'm sure there's plenty of ways to loosen them.
I smile broadly. Well, that could be arranged, perhaps.
Van thinking completely innocently, and Croak just like, oh, I know what you're talking about.
I said, I think that perhaps we might consider approach it. We were thinking of a different tactic than questioning him outright. Perhaps approaching him as traders that have exotic goods to sell may be that tack we may need.
I believe you and Malachi would be well suited for that job. I believe you could pose as a sailor. Malachi could pose for a merchant. I don't think I could do much for you. I have a stature that's a bit hard to simply shake off, and I kind of like angle the medallion a little bit and clink all the armor around.
Yes, I see. Well, perhaps as a hired god, I don't know. Maybe not at all, but that I would keep that in our back pocket for sure if the sailors do prove to be quite tight-lipped. It would be a good way to perhaps see how his business runs.
Yes, I believe we should take that as a second course of action. It's somewhat more risky, I believe. Perhaps if we can find something that may prove to be a more safe lead from the sailors, we may wish to take that. But otherwise, yes, I'd be willing to aid in that course of action.
Excellent. Well, I kind of like curl up at the foot of Van's bed and be like, I need to take a bit of a power nap here. I'll be off by sunup, and I just like go to sleep.
I kind of say, don't you have your own room?
Oh, this will do nicely. Thank you.
Croak, I understand. I understand our camaraderie knows no bounds, but I believe you may wish to go back to your room. I plan to stay up. I plan to keep the room well lit. I plan to do some studying before I go to sleep.
Oh, take your time. It's no problem. And I like find like a blanket or something, just kind of put it over my head and curl up at like the foot of his bed.
All right. The next day,
Van goes full.
Well, the sun up.
Right, sun up.
All right. Sun up comes, and I make my way to the Lusty Maiden.
By yourself? You're not taking Malachi or Van?
No, I've come to realize that these gentlemen need some time in the morning to themselves to do their magical whatnot.
All right. Give me spell lists for the two of you, if you don't mind.
Oh, yeah.
And let's head over to the Lusty Maiden with Croak. You show up. The place is not what it was last night. There's no... All the blinds are open. The window shutters are all open, streaming in light. People are pushing around brooms, cleaning up the place. Someone's mopping the stage. A few of the remaining sailors are, you know, groggily stumbling out the front door. And you see Mistress or Madam Chelsea, you're not sure which one to call her, standing, talking to a set of girls.
I make my presence known, just kind of like make sure she sees me, but I will stay quiet and kind of wait for her to take initiative there, like respectful of her authority.
A few minutes pass and she waves you over as the girls walk off. Okay. She looks and goes, well now, what did you say your name was, my fine fellow?
Oh, people call me Croak.
Right.
I quite like it. It's a unique name, to say the least.
Absolutely. I had a little chat with my girls. Seems no one really remembers speaking to Hitchens, but Boren is a regular here. Many of my ladies have spent quite a bit of time with him, some more than others.
I see.
That said, he is a repeat customer and quite good for business, so...
I
don't think I can help you any further on that matter.
I'm sorry. What was the last thing she said?
I don't think I can help you too much further on that matter. Boren is a loyal customer.
My dear, I would not think of harming your business. I just need to know more about what was discussed between them. Maybe a bit more about Mr. Boren's business. I'm sure that he is, of course... as a fine, upstanding gentleman in this here town, not going to be the one that did the stabbing, so to say.
What is it that you would like to know?
Well, I was hoping that, you see, Mr. Bowen's become quite a successful businessman, and it seems he's had dealings with not only a Mr. Hitchens, but other merchants around town. And I need to know what exactly that dealing was, because it seemed to be quite harmful to Mr. Hitchens' ledger book. And now, while this is no crime of its own, the process of this quite interests me.
Hmm.
I just simply need to know more about this man's business.
She starts to walk and kind of motions for you to walk with her. You see, Mr. Boren is a wealthy merchant in town. He frequents our establishment as he is a bachelor of an advanced age.
Mm-hmm.
Occasionally he will hire out one of our ladies or a few of our ladies for a prolonged how would you call it? Services.
A soiree, if you will.
That he takes back to his house. He's, as I've said a few times now, he is a loyal and regular customer here. And I can't really say too much about his business other than he does well for himself. And he works on the finer side of the industry here.
Oh,
he is definitely a... He's the sort of man that sees success as a challenge, and those who stand in his way as challengers. He has made it his job to be successful in life, and has done well.
I can truly admire a man that forges his own way. I would not wish to do ill upon him. I just would like to find some form of justice for a friend of mine, you see.
Yes, Mr. Hitchens.
I am certain that a man of his caliber would never do a deed himself. Perhaps by learning more of his business here, I can simply find the wielder of said dagger, and justice can be served. And your client...
Well, if you're looking for a guilty man who stabbed someone, you just have to step out onto the docks. Any one of them could be your murderer, and I wouldn't be surprised if most of them have murdered someone before. If you're looking for vengeance, you could kill any one of these people and achieve vengeance for someone, somewhere.
It's interesting, the notion of vengeance and justice. Some people, they quite enjoy just the pleasure of avenging a fallen comrade, but you see, it's justice that will really help those that are harmed, and it's that notion that matters more to a friend of mine named Jarrett. You see, he was cursed quite horribly by a wasting sickness, and it's not simple vengeance that will set his heart at ease.
Oh, Jarrett, the sea captain. He's got the sea skipper, right?
Yeah.
Is he still alive?
Absolutely.
You know,
thanks to
he used to be
work.
One of our most regular customers around. He spent most of his time here, actually. Haven't seen him in ages. I thought that his ship went on and sunk. Could never imagine that man leaving this establishment.
He found himself in Shirebrook. Was going to see his son, Malachi. And unfortunately, a terrible wasting sickness was upon him from his last dealings with a man named Boren. And this wasting sickness was fortunately cured by a powerful cleric in Shirebrook. His life was saved. We did see him here not too long ago. He was visiting Arosa. I'm sure that you'll be... Arosa?
Who is Rosa?
I do not rightfully know. A girlfriend, I'm certain, perhaps.
No, no. I know this man. He is not the sort to have a girlfriend.
Interesting.
Not for any prolonged period of time.
Hmm. That is a wonderful piece of information to know there. I would be
now,
much...
You tell me straight. I've been here to help you. Who is Rosa, and for whom does she work? Is there another establishment being set up around here?
Well,
do I have competition
what,
I am unaware of?
I do not rightfully know, but I will promise you this, due to your absolute great manners in helping me, I will do my utmost to find who, in fact, she does work for, and I will let you know, because there is absolutely no reason that the Lusty Maiden should be challenged by untoward competition.
We do not mind competition. We will destroy our competition with ease. I just need to know where it is.
I will let you know. I will let you know. Perhaps you've been quite helpful. Perhaps for this information, we could have a chat with one of your girls visits Mr. Bourne at his house.
She snaps her fingers and calls for a Giselle, who flounces over. You can see she looks exhausted, like she's been up all night. Her eyes kind of have that dead, hollow look in them. She goes, "Yes, Mistress Chelsea?" And Chelsea says, "This man, he wishes to ask you some questions."
Miss Giselle, it was. I'm sorry to keep you up any longer. I will try to make this as quick as possible. You have spent some time with a man named Bourne at his place?
She nods.
Excellent. Men like him, powerful men, driven by success, often will give a little brag or a little tale about their business. Tell me, have you heard anything about what he does from this man?
He's a merchant.
Mm-hmm. Have you heard anything about his means?
Buys and sells a lot of jewelry, a lot of silks, a lot of fine, careful wares, flatware made of iron or steel, some silver.
And what has he let slip anything about his relationship with other merchants, other gentlemen?
He's not the sort of man to spend too much time talking.
I understand. Tell me, did you see anything in his house, any friends drop by at these parties he throws?
She shakes her head. Sometimes he has me bring a friend along.
I understand. All right, well, I thank you for your time, Miss Giselle. Please, go back to sleep. You do look exhausted. I do not wish to keep you any longer.
She gives you a crude curtsy and leaves. Chelsea looks back to you and says, "I hope that was helpful, and I hope we can continue our mutually beneficial relationship. Would you like to avail yourself of some of my ladies?"
At this moment, I assure you I cannot. I have to meet a friend of mine.
If you're a little sly, I've got plenty of boys, too. We serve all kinds here.
Well, Mrs. Chelsea, I will gladly take you up on your offer, perhaps tonight, perhaps another evening, but you know that I will be back for sure.
She gives you a nod.
Please let me leave you, and I will find out more about this Rosa. Perhaps there's more to let you know.
Good day, Mr. Croak.
All righty. Now I will find my way back to the inn, hopefully to find Malachi and Van done
waking
doing their meditation and their wizardry planning.
Yes.
Study.
Has Malachi learned sleep yet?
No, it's been another day.
It's been another day. You still have not learned sleep.
You bastard. I'm going to fail this, goddamn.
This is the beginning of day 7. So we'll know for sure if he doesn't learn it by the end of day 7. He might learn it by the end of day 8, or he might, by the end of day 8, just be like, "I can't fucking learn this spell. God damn it."
God damn it is right.
Yeah. If you want to give up, you can always give up.
No.
Never give up. Never surrender.
Exactly.
All right, so I guess I'm down in the common room of the inn, eating breakfast, like flicking through the spell book at the same time. Mm-hmm. Just like frustrated with it. It's taking so long.
Mm-hmm. I think Van walks down just... stretches and goes, "Oh, it is wonderful to be in favor of the goddess."
Slam the book shut. Put it in my bag. Good morning, Van.
Good morning, Malachi. How is your wizardry been going? Your spells treating you all right?
I'm afraid the secrets of magic still elude me in some ways.
I see.
Perhaps
you would have been happier with the divine. There are no secrets here.
No, we've had this conversation before. I I think I'll stick to what I know.
I understand. You can't save everyone.
Yeah. Seems with your powers comes a lot of responsibility. Something that I don't like to have.
Some call it responsibility. I prefer to see it as a purpose. But to each their own.
Hmm.
You guys see Delta coming down from upstairs. He's the first mate on the Sea Skipper.
Yes.
Oh, I definitely want to whistle at him and get him over the table.
Yeah. Delta, come down. Eat with us.
He comes over, takes a seat with you, says, I ain't got much time. Your father's off with his lady friend, and we have not seen him since.
Yes, Mr. Delta, I want to question you on this lady friend here. Could you give me some more information about this Rosa? What do you
I ain't
know
never
about?
Seen her before. You he keeps her to her himself. Before? Yep.
And where does Jarrett go off to meet her?
I've never followed him. He's my captain. I don't spy on him.
Is he usually so coy about the women he meets with?
He doesn't usually meet with women in this regard. He usually frequents the lusty maiden. Keeps mm-hmm. it simple.
I had an interesting chat with Madam Chelsea. Maybe you're familiar with her.
Yeah.
She seems to be quite skeptical that Mr. Jarrett would settle down with any one woman. You've never met this lady before?
No. He jealously guards their secrecy. I ain't never seen him as happy as when he heads off to see her, though.
Do you find... When about did he start seeing Mrs. Rosa?
Probably been a month and a half now.
And so quite recently, and this seems to coincide with some wasting sicknesses and strange going on.
No. He didn't get sick until, let's see, we were in Redport. We left, came back 2 weeks later. No, he met her the last time, we were in Redport before the time that he got sick.
Met her again on the second trip?
Yeah, this is only the third time we've been in Redport since, well, the second time since we met her. This would be the third time being in Redport that he's gone to see her.
Right. Were you there when he met her, or?
No, he just came back to the ship one day as we were about to head off, talking about this lovely woman that he met that changed his life and how he was going to give up his previous ways, because love is a more noble pursuit than lust.
Would you say he's completely love-stricken?
Like a child.
And none of you have ever met this woman?
No.
This is...
Strange.
Strange, to say the least.
Maybe not. I presume you all have seen love once or twice in your life.
Yes, I don't doubt his sincerity to his love. It's jealously guarding her from not just your company, but your eyes. The fact that none of you have ever seen this woman.
He shrugs.
This is...
Would you have any idea where he's heading off to when he sees her at all?
Heads towards the south side of town. I don't know where on the south side, but when we part ways, he heads southward.
Does he meet her multiple times while they're in town, or while you're in town?
What are you guys getting at here, huh?
I'm simply wondering if he's going to meet her again, or if this is his one trip of the...
He looks directly to Malachi and says, you know my loyalties lie to your father. They extend to you, but first to him.
Do you not think it's somewhat suspicious, Delta? I'm just trying to exhaust all angles here to try and work out...
There may be something odd about that, but I ain't never seen him quite so happy before. If something suspicious has made him this happy, I only wish to see it furthered.
Well, Mr. Delta, is it so strange to think that Mr. Malachi here might want to see his new stepmom? I think that would make your father even happier to get the family back together, you know.
Oh... Malachi's too old to have a stepmom. Aren't you, son?
Yeah. Look, you know as well as us, this seems a little bit suspicious, and given everything that happened to my father. Would you not think we should exhaust all angles here?
I asked him about it. He said that no way. I mean, she loves him. Why would she hurt him? Far more likely something else came up somewhere else.
There are spells, Delta, that could have an effect that seems like love.
Well, he ain't never taken any money there. Well, no more than he carries on him. He ain't ever given her anything, or sold her anything, or bought anything from her. If there's no money changing hands, what else could it be but love?
Yeah, no, I believe that it's love. I'm just saying that perhaps this Rosa isn't just your average maiden.
She bewitched him with a spell and made him love her, but she loves him back, so, you know.
I kind of, like, motion to Malachi and say, don't worry, Malachi. If this is truly the work of foul play, I have means of detecting it.
Don't you go breaking his heart.
I won't go breaking his heart. Understand that my loyalties lie toward Malachi's father as well. I may not be one of his crew, but I am here to help him. Mm. I'm here to track down those who attempted to harm him.
If my father turns back up, you come and get me, okay? Leave a message for me here. I'm sure I'll be here most of the time.
We have plenty of business to attend to. I ain't got time for running around.
Well, you find someone who does have time and send them to leave a message.
He grunts, gets up from the table, and walks out with his meal half-eaten.
I kind of turn to Malachi and say quietly, do you believe this is the work of somebody attempting to charm him with magic?
I don't know about all of that, but let me tell you, I know my father quite well, and aside from, I can't think of a single person that he'd pay this much attention to, not even me. Up and left me when I was a kid, didn't come back for more than 5 minutes at a time. Maybe he is just in love, but perhaps if this woman's so great, maybe she's attracted the eyes of a few more men who perhaps can hold a grudge.
This is true. What we should do first, tomorrow morning I can memorize a new spell. This spell will allow me to deal with the most extreme issue that could be at play here. I would be able to detect if he's under the form of any magical form of charm, whether it be from a cleric casting it or a monster projecting it.
I think it's important to at least rule that out.
Yes, I agree. And that's the first thing I can do tomorrow morning.
All right. Croak, did you get any leads from speaking to Madame Chelsea this morning?
I spoke with one of the girls that has visited Mr. Bolin a few times at his place. It seems that they did not overhear anything interesting. However, I was made aware of this Rosa girl and how that she was very sure of herself, Miss Chelsea, that such a girlfriend's dynamic would not exist for Mr. Jarrett. It seems to me that she was quite honest and forthright about it, too. And having heard what I have from yourself about the man, I'm quite interested in finding more about this Rosa woman. See if we can't locate her. And at the very least, maybe get some eyes on your new mother.
Well, how do we feel, Byron, Rosa? Are they connected?
Whether they're connected at this point, I can't say.
I do feel as if Mr. Boren is definitely up to some, shall we say, shenanigans with the merchants and some price fixing. And it's worth continuing to keep an eye on. But I'm beginning to suspect that it may be connected still. But I think our best lead may be to discover more about this Rosa woman.
Yes, I think our first priority is toward your father. I do. Yes, if this investigation may not take us down the road that we're looking to go, I believe for now, we may wish to direct our attention toward this Rosa character.
I agree. We don't want to ruffle any feathers with Boren and get ourselves in any trouble that we don't need to get into.
Exactly.
It's cooler on the investigation for a day or two. Let things lie. Maybe revisit.
Perhaps this man isn't even worth our time. Right now, all of our efforts should be going toward helping your father.
If what we suspect is perhaps true, then maybe he's still in danger.
I don't believe this will be the time he doesn't come back. I wouldn't worry too much about it. I will...
Look, maybe we should... Delta said that he heads to the south side of town. Maybe we should just head down there and take a look around. Maybe find a tavern. Take a drink.
I agree with you. I think we might have more luck more around the south side of town looking for this woman. I also think it may be worth checking out other sailors that are not associated with your crew. If she's approached one sailor, perhaps she's approached another different time.
Mm. At least if we go down there and ask around, maybe somebody will have seen my father, seen him go into a house or an establishment. Van?
Hmm.
It's possible. I don't wish to intrude today, though. If we go... Let's focus on most of this tomorrow. If we find her tomorrow, we can work from there, but...
First, I want to cast that spell and ensure that your father is not under the form of any sort of magic still.
We've got no way of knowing when he'll return. We have to take the initiative on this one, I think.
Is he gone for multiple days at a time, Neil?
In town for a few days...
I meant, does he like vanish to Roses for multiple days?
No,
or does
he's actually he said he'd be coming by this morning if he could, if you recall correctly.
Hmm. So I say, Malachi, let's simply wait until he drops by. We can speak with him. I don't wish to press too hard on this because I want to make sure he comes back tomorrow morning as well, because then I can cast the spell and ensure there's no foul play. And
he said
from
he
there,
would come to the tavern this morning.
Yeah. He said he would try and make it to the tavern this morning. But...
Okay, Croak stands up and starts walking to the south side of town. I'm hoping to find him walking towards the tavern to get an idea of where he came from.
So the town's kind of big. You know, if you were to take a path to the south side of town, there's no guarantee, even if he was coming from the south side of town to your side at the same time, that you would cross. Because, you know, it's a big area. South is many, many blocks, and there's many avenues that could be taken.
Are you saying he should roll a d20?
I'm saying it's possible, but unlikely, that to run into him coming this way. You'd have to know where, you know, if he's down by the beach, he would be coming up by the boardwalk. If he's over by the west, southwest corner, he'd be coming up that way. If he's in the middle of the south side of town, you know, there's many avenues of approach. Do you have a particular section of the south side of town you'd like to head to?
Yeah, I want to go away from the docks and the beach area, because if she's taking them away from there, I don't think she's close by. I don't think she would be in a particularly like rich or wealthy area, so if there's like a place that's noble or more high-end, I would probably stick to like a middle-class area.
Okay. All right, so you start heading in that direction. Malachi and Van Helsing, what are you guys doing?
Yes, we wait around, see if he turns up.
Okay.
Yeah, I think
I do some studying.
Okay. Kill. Yeah, Malachi studies.
He does show up like half an hour later, 45 minutes later.
Great. Father!
How are you doing this fine morning, Malachi? And what a morning it is.
I go up and I shake his hand and like grip him around the shoulder and sort of smell his breath. Does he smell like he's been drinking or anything like that? Does he have like a perfume scent on him or something?
He does have a strange smell to him, probably the smell of whoever it is that he's been associating with. But his breath doesn't smell like alcohol right now.
Does it smell like perfume though? Like the scent of a woman?
Yes.
Father, sit down. Would you like something to drink?
Love something to drink. Absolutely. Some drinks are brought over. The drink and food here is not actually great. It's decent, you know, but it's not the finest restaurant in town.
I bring up with, what's his name? It's Gerent?
Gerent, yeah.
I say, Gerent, I know that we cured this issue some while back, but I would like to, I assume you remember the time when you fell ill.
I thank you for your services. I am so sorry to see you run out of town and now wanted. For saving my life. I can never thank you enough.
Don't even worry about that. The reason I bring it up is if you could come by tomorrow morning, I would like to run a few more tests to make sure that you are... Or I say tests. I have a few spells that I can memorize tomorrow morning to ensure that you are going to be in lasting health, and the issues that affected you before will not return.
Huh?
The disease that befell you was a magical ailment, and I simply want to make sure that the magic has been completely dispelled.
You think... Oh, well, yeah.
Yes. I'm sure it'll be fine, but I would like to be safe about this. I don't know how much longer we're going to be together. I'd rather get this done.
It's for the best, Father. It's just to be safe.
No, I appreciate that. We'll be heading off pretty soon, depending on trades and whatnot. Either tomorrow or the day after, we'll be leaving.
Very well. Something that might be worth noting. Neil, you have to touch somebody to do cure disease, right? I would know that because I cast it on a scroll.
Cure disease is touch, yes.
Okay. So I say, tell me, I don't mean this in any sort of way that might, or I don't mean this in any sort of significant way, but would you happen to remember, are you often, like, do you brush against many people? Do you come in contact, physical contact with many people while you're in Redport?
Absolutely. Docks are bustling. You run into people all the time. Some areas you have to squeeze or even push people apart to get through.
Would you know of anyone who may have laid their hands on you while you were here last time? The magic that would have caused your disease would have required them to be in physical contact with you.
Yeah, that would be real easy to do. Real easy. Anyone could come up to you in a crowd.
They would have to be more... They'd have to lay their hands on you directly. They couldn't simply, like, brush up past you. They would have to stop long enough to cast the spell. Which I think might help narrow it down somewhat.
I shook hands with many people. Can you cast spells while shaking hands with someone?
I would assume, yes. Assuming you have the spell prepared. I'm asking you, Neil, because I would know that, right?
What are the components of... Cure disease is somatic and verbal, so there would have to be some sort of words and movements made with it. It would be pretty obvious if someone's casting a spell in front of you.
Okay. I say there would have to be some sort of... Including when you cast it by the scroll, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I say somebody would have had to made a very clear gesture of it. They would have been moving somewhat strangely, speaking words you didn't understand. Did you shake hands with anybody who was foreign, perhaps? Listing off goods that you didn't recognize the names of? I've had a wizard attempt that trick on me before.
I spoke with some dwarves.
No, that doesn't sound right.
Dwarves are capable of casting clerical magic.
Yeah, but we've had a good relationship for decades now. I can't imagine them turning south. We've never had a problem. They're trustworthy folk, and loyal folk, as long as you don't try and screw them over.
I see.
Profit margin is not great with them, but they are a guaranteed source of income.
Do you ever go to temples, churches to pray? It's fine if you don't. I'm not asking you in a accusatory way.
I simply want to know because a cleric did this to you, and I'm wondering if it was perhaps one of the ones in town.
No, I haven't been inside a temple.
Father,
can't
these dwarves, they put their prices up. Much like our friend Hitchens. Oh,
no. No. Uh-uh.
Did you ever find out why Hitchens raised his prices so much?
Never did. I was going to ask him about it this time after heads had cooled, but sadly he is dead.
Yeah. We were looking into that. You think maybe the same person that killed him has anything to do with what happened to you?
Could be, but could also not be. I mean, I don't know why anyone would come after me to begin with. Look at
this,
me.
This boring guy, you and him exchanged any bad words, any bad blood between the two of you?
You know, Hitchens raised his prices, and I was trying to go sell at Born too, but he... you say to one person, your prices are too high... I won't sell at that rate, or your prices are too low, I won't sell, so you go talk to another person. I don't know if I was just let it slip or what, or maybe he's just too good at reading faces, but man, I did not make a good deal with that man.
Did you have any, you did make the deal, I assume?
Yeah.
Did you give him any cause to be angry with you, or did he simply
Well, I mean, you negotiate, you argue, you yell, you insult each other's mothers, but then you make a deal and you go on your way.
Nothing out of the ordinary?
I can't think so. He did say he wanted to buy my ship, but I told him it wasn't for sale, and that kind of was the end of that.
Interesting. Did you leave immediately afterwards?
No, that was the first day in town. We stayed for 3 days then. We were supposed to be headed off towards, Keldoram. But I fell ill and we came back home instead. We'll be headed off to Keldoram when we do leave this time.
Well, enough about business, Father. Why don't you tell me about my future mother-in-law?
Oh, well, I don't know if all that's in order. I mean, you know, we ain't planning on having any more kids. I don't know if marriage is the sort of thing that would suit the two of us. Although, I tell you the truth, I had a mind to maybe retire and settle down here in Redport. And if she'll let me, I would marry that woman in a heartbeat.
She must be some woman, Father.
You know, I never really believed in love before this.
Well, I can't quite believe what I'm seeing.
Unless you know, I say with one of these days, maybe eyes. You'll meet her, huh?
Well, why don't we're both in town together. It's quite rare these days. Maybe you'd allow me to purchase dinner for the three of us.
I got a lot of work to do, and I think... Well, I don't think dinner's the sort of thing that'd be appropriate with you around.
Surely we can... You can understand why I would want to meet her. Someone stolen your heart this much? I've never seen you this happy.
Well, you're an educated man. You've got your eyes open to the world. You've managed all sorts of witchcraft and sorcery. No offense, son. I think you're a smart lad. Sure. Just the two of us, though. No offense, boys. Just my son and I.
Oh, I understand.
Family event. Family, you know. Yeah.
Yes.
Sure. Why don't you meet me at the Sea Skipper an hour before sundown?
Sure.
How should I dress? Just as is. She is not... Don't even worry about the manner of dress. She is not a fancy lady.
Very well. Fun?
Never mind. If you're going to have dinner with her tonight, so be it. That is fine.
Well, Father, what have you got planned for the rest of today?
Oh, I got business to do. We gotta offload some goods and pick up some new things. As I said, we're heading to Keldoram, and them dwarves have a particular taste for metals. We got a guy here who's unloading some mithril we're gonna try and buy up and send over to Keldoram.
Mithril?
Mithril ore. Yeah.
My.
Kind of a big ship to carry mithril, but, you know, it's worth its weight, well, more than in gold. It's worth 20, 30 times its weight in gold. Good stuff.
Does mithril work for making weapons?
Rightly so. Hmm. Better weapons than bronze or steel.
I see. I don't mean to... I mean, obviously, I would not want to cut into your business, but if you truly are thankful for the time that we saved your life, it would be good. Perhaps negotiate a deal with whoever you sell the mithril to craft a weapon for us.
I guess that would be a fair thing. You did save my life and all. Did you have something in mind?
A scimitar. If I could have a mithril scimitar, that would be fantastic.
The crew will yell bloody murder, but I suppose I could work it out with them and give up my fair share of the next few runs.
Yes, as long as it won't be anything too damaging to your profits.
Who am I to say no to you who saved my life? Of course, I will see what I can do when we visit Keldoran.
nice.
I don't know when next we'll have a chance to meet. How am I supposed to find you?
We may be in Redport for some time yet. If not, I believe our next stop would be to go back to Anvil. So if next time you arrive in Redport, we are not here. If you have the time to take a detour to Anvil...
What a little backwater that is. All right. Will do.
Charming enough. As backwater as it may be.
Yeah. Sounds good. All right, I gotta go. I got shit to do. He gets up and leaves. Croak, you are walking through the streets.
I am.
Where are you going? You know, you're looking for...
I'm looking for him coming the other way.
You definitely don't spot him. No.
Obviously, that doesn't happen.
Yeah.
So I begin casing the streets as I did the previous afternoon, resuming in a presumably different place. And I'll make my way to, like, some kind of tavern in the area. Whatever kind of inn or tavern where people gather. I'm looking for a gathering of people, basically, in this area as I go. Okay.
You find a tavern. Mm-hmm. It has on the sign dangling out front, there is a picture of a child with X's over its eyes. And a lot of noise coming out from inside of it.
This seems about the right place.
Yeah, this is actually quite near the docks as well.
Okay, so I went to the docks unawares. Okay.
Well, yeah, you wandered through the town and this is the one that you found.
Sure. Yeah, I find myself a pretty rowdy inn. I look inside, kind of order myself my awful drink. I begin making small talk with a bunch of the just kind of rowdy people that are in there. Maybe there's a game of dice. Maybe I play some of that with them. I'll make sure to lose a few silver coins or something.
Mm-hmm.
I'm essentially looking for someone that I think may. I guess during my small talk, I'm throwing in a little bit of thieves' cant to find myself somebody that might be in an organization or so here, or at least knows the people. I'm looking for connections, basically.
Yeah, you find a guy who you throw in some thieves' cant, and he replies. You find a fellow thief.
Excellent, excellent. I ask him, do you know where the rooster nests around here? I'm looking for the... kind of the boss or the man.
We don't rightly have a boss lying around. A lot of freelance work gets done. No oversight. It's a great day to be alive.
I see. You know, I was hoping maybe you know someone with a little bit of influence. You see, I have some intel, and I didn't know who to give it to.
What do you know?
Oh well, are you the right person? You see, I need to know this is going to the right people.
I mean, we've been playing this game for a few minutes now. We're practically blood brothers. You tell me what you know, and I will do my best to find you. You get it to the right person.
Oh, excellent!
I'll split
excellent.
That commission with you.
Well, you see, there's a gem jeweler came into town.
Uh-huh.
He's walking around trying to offload some rather expensive peridot gems.
Oh, I see.
New man off the ship. Yeah, yeah. And I think I know exactly where to find him tonight. And I was hoping that maybe we could find the right person to give this information to. You see, I'm not much of a doer myself, but I do peddle in information.
Do you have someone to fence it to, these gems?
That is my specialty, my friend.
I know a guy that can get them. If you can give me details about where he'll be and... what sort of security he'll have, and if you can fence him, then I think between the three of us, we can do a nice even split.
I see. Well, you see here, this is my thing. I'm a little bit new here. I've worked plenty of places, but this is my first time in Redport, and you see, this is my big score, right? I don't want necessarily to get one score with it. I want to get a few more. I want to make sure to find the right people to get in with, you see.
Hmm.
Are you it? Or do you know the right people? I'm sure we can cut you in. I wouldn't dare leave a brother out.
No, I know well enough around this town, but a lot of things here work on merit. Talk is cheap. Anyone can bluster.
Mm-hmm.
If you can deliver, if you can... find out who this guy is, how many security guards he's got, where they'll be, where he's staying, what room he's staying in, and if you can fence the gems, well, I think that's a good showing, and I think that's a sort of trust, a sort of thing that earns trust around here.
I see. And who has delivered here before?
Oh.
Who's the man to get it done?
It's not really a man to get it done.
Who's the woman?
I like the way you think, buddy. But no, there aren't very many of us here. Things have been tight. Restrictions have loosened since the siege. And things are flowing freely now. I think it's everyone out for themselves. It's kind of a dog-eat-dog world at the moment. But I think that's why we ought to stick together, you know? Everyone working on their own. A couple of people start working together. Gives us an edge.
I see. All right, well.
Yeah?
You get 3-4 boys together. And I'll let you know that the man with the peridot gems, mm-hmm. he's staying at the Boar's Head Hotel, or the Hobgoblin's Head, and I give him Van's room as the room number.
Whoa. And how many guards does he have?
Well, he is quite a formidable person himself, but he travels in a group of 3.
Mm-hmm. What's he look like?
I describe Van very well, his kind of like waifish, like feminine appearance, but wears armor. And I say, I leave out the fact that he's a cleric, but I describe like a good, you know, I make him sound, I make a good description of Van and make him sound like a, you know, good merchant. Mm-hmm. I talk about Malachi and his kind of appearance and say, these are the two you need to look out for.
Do you mention anything about Malachi being a spellcaster?
No.
Yeah. And the third man?
Third man's just a fella, kind of sticks to the shadows, keeps quiet. I give a description of like one of my brothers, okay. but who's like thin and in shape.
Right. He nods slowly and goes, okay. He'll be there tonight?
He'll be there tonight. I know that he has a deal in place to sell the gems, to Mr. I don't know, Bolin, perhaps?
Boren.
And Boren, yeah, that's the name. But if we can get to him first, his guard's going to be just themselves the inn. They're quite confident they can take care of themselves, but there'll be more at the time of the sale, so we need to act tonight. Mm. Now, bear in mind, I'm not an actor. I'm just the one with the information and the fencing, so you guys got to show up and do the deed. You understand?
Yeah. I think we can do this. Hobgoblin's Head is a busy place. Difficult to get in and out, but he keeps normal sleeping hours?
Yes, he does.
I seem to recall that room, it's a corner room, second floor.
Yeah.
Probably get in through the alley window. I'll mm-hmm. get some boys together, see what we can do. You said you want to keep using him for business?
If you need to, we could get rid of him. The 6 gems are
probably
the real score here, but what we need to do is basically I want to use this to leverage myself, you know. I want influence in this here town. Not only one score, but many more. I want to make sure that the right people are involved in this.
You're trying to make a name for yourself.
Exactly.
What's your name?
I give him a name. I call myself like
Ribbit.
I make up a name. I call myself Dorian.
Dorian.
Dorian. Oh,
that's
Gray.
That's a fitting. Yeah, I was gonna say that's a fitting name.
John Dorian. Okay. He nods and says, all right, well, we'll have your gems by morning. You meet me back here at Infant Mortality, and we'll see it done.
Sounds good. Okay. With that...
Are you just getting murdered in my sleep?
No. With that, I return to the Hobgoblin's Head. And begin rounding up the 3 of you, and I say, I hear there's bounty hunters that know our location. They are coming for us this evening. I've kept my ear and nose to the ground, and it turns out Mr. Jarrett was right. They've heard of our comings here, and they know what room we're in. But I think we can turn the tables on them. We're on a corner room. I believe they're going to try to come in through the alley up the wall. If we're patient and waiting for them tonight, perhaps we can end this threat of bounty hunters once and for all.
Unfortunately, Croak, I've got plans for this evening.
Oh, well, that is unfortunate. Are you sure that you need too much time with your plans? What are you up to?
Will you not be back tonight, Malachi?
Depends how it goes, I suppose. I'll probably be back.
I don't suppose they're going to invite you into sleep.
I don't suppose I'd take up the offer. Well,
yes, that would be a bit strange.
I'll come back as soon as I can. But this is grave news, Croak. Although I suppose it's better that we know now rather than be surprised.
Yes,
exactly.
On the bright side, there is no legal jurisdiction for them to attack us in town. We will have the law on our side in this case.
Well, if we kill them there and then, though,
they'll be broken into one of our rooms. You know where they're coming.
Absolutely. I say we wait until they come in and slaughter them. Make sure that no bounty hunter gets back alive.
Well,
deceitful and awful bunch it is, those bounty hunters.
Look, I've got some stuff to take care of in town the next couple of hours. I'm going to go head out, but I should be back before this evening. I'll speak to you both then.
Sounds good.
All right. Neil, I want to go shopping.
What would you like to go buy?
Hear me out here. I want to buy a guard dog.
Ah.
You need some coin?
No, it's not even that expensive.
Okay.
Go ahead.
There's no stats for a guard dog in the rule book, but there is a war dog, and in the player's handbook, guard dogs cost more than war dogs, so I'd say it's a war dog stat line with... You know, it can be trained, I suppose, better
right,
to be a guard
right.
dog.
So, Redport does not have a kennel master. There's no, like, place that's selling guard dogs. But there are other guard dogs around. Perhaps you could buy one off of someone else?
Yeah. maybe I'll just, like, walk along the docks then, and I'll look for somebody who's got, like, a few dogs on their ship, maybe.
Mm-hmm.
See if they can spare one.
Yeah. As you walk along the docks, you definitely find both some shops that have some very large dogs kind of standing outside. One of them's lying down inside the doorway in a sunbeam. You see some ships with dogs on them. There's plenty of dogs about.
Well, let's start with the shop then.
Okay.
So I go up to the guy running the shop, say, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Are you looking to get your ship refilled? We have the best water in town. Not a lick of lead.
I was looking to buy something, but mayhaps not what you had in mind.
Oh?
Too soon, Neil.
Look, I'm on a short deadline here, so I haven't got time to wait around. I've noticed you've got these two lovely dogs out here. I was looking at investing in some protection for myself. And unfortunately, I can't find anyone in town breeding them. Maybe I could take one off your hands for the right price.
My pups are not for sale, but I have a friend whose dog just had a litter of pups. It'll be probably a few years before maybe a year before they're really big and tough, but you want a guard dog? You want to train it from a pup? My friend Jacqueline's just had some pups.
As much as I'd love that, I really haven't got time to wait. I need the security now. Your friend Jacqueline, maybe she knows some more people with other dogs?
She's got a few of her own. She's not a breeder, but she's had more than a few bitches give birth to a litter.
Well, I'll tell you what. Mind you give me her location, and I'll see if she can help.
Yeah, of course. He gives you the location of Jacqueline.
Thanks a lot, that friend. You have a good day.
You too.
All right.
You head over to Jacqueline's. We'll just boop, 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 boop. another part of town, and she is running a general store. She looks like this is further in, well away from the docks, well away from all the sailors and the rowdiness of that section. It's a nice, quiet general store-esque area.
Yeah, so I just walk in and start looking around at the items.
Yeah. There's not very many people in here, so she immediately, you know, calls over to you and says, "Hey there! Is there anything I can help you with? Anything you're looking to buy?"
Hey there. Jacqueline, I presume?
That's the name. Don't wear it out.
Yeah, this might sound like a strange request. I was speaking to a friend of yours. He said that you know something about dogs.
Ooh, are you looking to buy some puppies? I have a litter of puppies, 2 months old.
As much as I love puppies, I really haven't the time to train one up, let it grow, mature. I was looking for something I could use as a guard dog. Quick, I can't find a kennel master in town.
Ooh, yeah, we don't have one around here. You might want to try Clydesdale. But if you need something sooner than that, I am more than happy to oblige. Scooby, come here, Scooby. And this big bloodhound, long droopy cheeks, wanders over.
Alright, I look at it like, how old is he? And check his, like, weight and stuff.
Oh, he's going on 8 now.
I look at his teeth.
They look pretty good. He's kind of drooly.
Well, he seems like a fine dog. He's a little old, though. What say you to 20 gold?
Let me check the player's handbook prices. You might... Dog. She nods. That's a square deal.
Very well. There you go. I give her the 20 gold.
Okay. She bows down and or squats down, and gives Scooby a big scratch and puts a leash around his neck. He doesn't have a collar, so she just kind of like wraps it around him and hooks it in. Okay. And hands you the leash, and then squats down and goes, "Scooby, this is your new master. Scooby, this is what'd you say your name was?"
Malachi.
Scooby, this is Malachi. Scooby, here. She reaches behind the counter and gives you a chicken bone with still a lot of meat dangling off the end of it.
Sure,
not
yeah.
A chicken bone. Chicken bones are bad for dogs. Like a
lamb leg.
Lamb leg. There we go.
I crouch down in front of him then and sort of like stroke his head and then hand him the lamb leg.
Okay. He eagerly goes for it. I think that you now have a dog.
Nice. Neil, can I write some stuff down here?
Sure.
War dog. Name. Scooby. My first dog as a child was called Scooby.
Oh, no way.
Yeah. It's weird. All right. Okay. Can I roll some HP?
Yeah, give me 2d8 plus 2 for his HP.
This guy's going to be the most formidable party member. 2d8 plus 2.
Mm-hmm.
8.
Oh, not horrible.
It's not bad. What's his AC?
AC 6. Movement 12.
Right. Nice.
One attack for 2d4 damage.
Well, Scooby, come with me. And I start walking down the docks and head back to the inn.
Okay. You now have Scooby.
Neil.
Mm-hmm.
So, is Croak still hanging around the inn with me?
Yeah.
Okay, I say, Croak, now that we're in a new city, would you like to see if we can't find somebody selling a longbow?
Oh, by all means.
Yes, I would be more than happy to split the cost with you. And sure. I guess we head out to the town and look for somebody who's selling like military kind of style weapons.
Redport is bustling with weapons and armor and that sort of thing. After asking around a little bit, you can find a Fletcher who does indeed have a bow, a longbow, on hand ready to sell.
I ask if he has sheaf arrows he can sell with it as well.
He does. He's got everything you need.
All right, so I want to get a longbow, and is it something that would be divisible to 24 or just 20 sheaf arrows? Whatever make the cost come out even. I don't have the books here with me.
Right, so sheaf arrows are 1 silver for 2. So 10 silver for 20.
Okay,
And then the bow is...
The bow is 75 gold. So 76 gold.
Yeah. That'd come out to... Oh, God. 38
each of you. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I just kind of throw in my half and...
Okay, yeah. I'll pay 38 gold for your bow. We agreed on that deal.
And then I give him my short bow and all the flight arrows.
Fantastic. I thought I already had those...
I might not have to take it.
I think at the end.
Oh yeah, you have it still.
Yeah, I still just have them. Neil, as we wandered through town, I want to keep my eye out for a armorer. Specifically, seeing if anyone has field plate available.
There is an armorer in town. No one has. Field plate just sitting around because it needs to be crafted specifically to a person.
I thought maybe there would be field plate that like they had purchased or had made, but it like the deal fell through and it was like waiting for adjustments to be sold to someone else.
Perhaps. No. When you custom order something like field plate, it is, you know, you're talking someone spending like 2,000 gold pieces. So that sort of business deal doesn't really fall through.
Okay.
You can have some field plate custom made for you, but it will take a while, like a long while to make.
I kind of float an idea out to Sean, just or to Van, just kind of like, man, it sure would be nice to get you in a beautiful glistening set of plate armor, wouldn't it?
It would. If you can toss me a couple thousand gold, I'd be more than happy to make the purchase.
Yeah, we must find a way to get you into something like that one of these days. But I leave it kind of just dangling out there for now.
Okay,
just so you fully understand.
Field plate's 2,000 gold in the player's handbook.
Right, and the time to make it would be...
Probably a couple weeks.
16 weeks?
Yeah.
Yeah, it takes 16 weeks to make. Now, you might be able to find someone who's already got some of the components lying around. You might be able to find someone who will make it a little bit faster, but the price will probably go up.
Sure.
Anyway, let's skip on towards evening, unless there's something the two of you want to do.
No, that was it. I got the bow and I got the arrow. What are the weights on those, actually? That's one thing I need to know. It's, I assume, 2 pounds for the arrows because they're a pound per 10.
Yep.
And then the bow is...
I want to say like it's 3 pounds.
I think it's 5, isn't it?
No.
Am I wrong?
I think you're wrong.
They're
on that.
Really
I think
light.
It's
they're just like shafts of wood.
3 pounds for the long bow, 2 pounds for the short bow.
Okay.
I'm wrong.
Neil, I spend the remaining hours until sunset studying with Scooby in my room.
You get your 8 hours of study in.
Do I learn the spell?
Not by the end of today.
Is that one more day or is that
one
it?
One more day.
Okay.
Next day is... Pass or fail.
You might have rolled like a 9 or a 10, and he just shortened it down to 8 for you. So you're not totally like just, oh, God.
Yeah. No,
a
1 in 8
chance of being successful here. So you head
that's
down.
That's not how it works.
No, it's not how it works at all. you head down to, you meet up with your father, and he takes
now,
you.
Do I bring the dog?
Do you bring the dog?
Yeah, I think I do.
You could leave him with me.
I know he might be useful in the attempt on our lives, but I think I'll bring the dog with me.
Okay.
I need to get used to being around me.
Okay. You bring the dog with you. Your dad meets up with you and takes you down towards the docks and then just kind of down along the coast towards the south wall. The harbor kind of gives way just to open beach. Kind of open, empty beach in a rather desolate part of town. The mainland on that area, not the coast, has some kind of buildings, and it looks a little bit more slummy. And as you approach the south wall, you notice that there is a little shack built on the beach, a small one-room little shack on the beach.
Father, I thought you'd go for settle down with a lady with a bit more class, no?
Hey, now, son, you haven't met her yet. Now, you just, look, you're an educated man. You know the ways of the world. Things are not always what they seem. I just keep an open mind, all right? This woman has, is a wonderful woman, and I love her very much. Just,
I'm sorry, Father. I spoke out of turn.
Don't judge someone before you've had a chance to speak with them and talk to them and really know who they are as a person. All right?
Now, I suppose so.
She doesn't know you're here, so let me go in and talk to her first before I just bring you in uninvited. You understand?
Sure, yes. I'll wait here.
All right, he steps inside. You're outside with Scooby.
How's Scooby acting? Is he chill?
He's kind of chill, but he seems a little confused about who you are and why you're carrying him around.
That's all right, yeah.
You hear some chatter inside, very faintly. And then your dad starts to walk back out while you hear a woman start to sing a really lovely song, a really just beautiful song echoes from inside the shack. And I need you to make me a saving throw versus spell. But why don't we do that when we come back from break? See you guys on the other side. Bye-bye.
That seemed so likely. Oh.